Hi there. In this tutorial, I'm going to demonstrate how to use a liquid simulation as the source for a fire simulation. The sample I did in Eevee, so there are some limitations on how realistic the fire and so on is going to appear, but to render that in cycles would have taken me many, many more hours than it did in Eevee. So it was a compromise and that's what I went with. So putting aside how realistic or otherwise the fire looks, the key thing here is the fact that I used the liquid itself as the source for the flame. I added something which caused the flame not to be just a complete mass all over the liquid, but nevertheless you can see as the liquid expands, the area of fire expands as well. So that's really what this tutorial is about. So to begin with, let's just create a very simple fluid simulation, and I'll start just by adding a small cylinder. Just rotated it. We'll rotate it 45 and we'll put it somewhere like this. I actually ended up using just a plane, but we'll go with a cylinder for now. And then I'm going to go to Object, Quick Effects, Quick Liquid. And you can see that's created a domain around the object. And if I press play, you may just be able to see there's a load of little dots, if I go into orthographic view, that represent the volume of liquid that would have been enclosed by that cylinder. But that's not exactly what we were looking for, although this would work as well. So if I click that cylinder name and go to the physics properties, you can see here's our liquid settings. And rather than saying flow type liquid and behavior geometry, I'm going to change the behavior to inflow. And then I'm going to go under flow source, make sure it's set to mesh. If you use a plane, make sure you select is planar, and you can do that anyway. And have an initial velocity, and I put something like 0.65 for X on there. So that's really how fast it emits. And we'll need to go to the domain and just make it rebake. So let's just change the resolution here. And you can now see we've got fluid pouring in. You can just about see it there, but at the moment it's just doing the fluid particles. I want it to do the mesh, so I need to come further down and you'll see there's an option for mesh there. Now all of a sudden that's changed. So if I press play now, you can see it's simulating the actual mesh as well. And if I go to solid view, you can see that how that's working. So we'll go to edit view and we'll scale shift Z the domain up a little bit so we can have a wider area of fluid, and come out of edit and press play again. And obviously what we also need to do is apply scale to both objects and then make it rebake again. We'll just select the domain and just change that, and that will make it resample and start to rebake it. And now we can see, so we've got a fluid there building up and then it hits the walls. Now you can have it creep up the walls, or you can tell it that the walls are not collision. So currently everything is set to collision, so this will fill up. If you want a thicker fluid, if we come down to here and we select diffusion, it's a bit of a confusing name to be honest, but if you select it, you can then go to some settings which will allow you to change the behavior of the fluid. And there are some presets if you click here. So if I go to honey, I will need to make it rebake again, and I'll just change a couple of parameters there. And you can see the fluid will flow in a more sticky and viscous way. It's still coming in at the same rate, but it's not as watery as the previous fluid. So let's just set the end of this animation to 100 frames. And that's baked the whole lot. Other than changing the viscosity of the fluid and telling it to render a mesh, I haven't really done anything else with this. I'll set the end of the cache to 100. And because I've got it on replay type, that's what allows me to just click play and it starts doing the simulation. When you go up to higher resolutions, you may want to change this to modular, which allows you to bake some of it, see how it's going, and then decide whether you want to bake more of it, because with the higher resolutions it will take a lot longer per frame and you probably don't want to be doing it by just playing the animation. But for my purposes, this will be fine for the fire simulation. So one of the problems is you can only really have one physics simulation on a mesh at a time. Otherwise it would be easy just to use this mesh as the source for our fire simulation. But because you can't do that, you need an intermediary. So I'm going to add another mesh, which is a plane. And I'm going to scale that up a bit, and then I'm going to subdivide it. So I've gone into edit mode, select subdivide, and let's just add some subdivisions. Let's try 25. It may need more subdivisions, but we'll see how we go. If I go on with my animation, I want to put the plane somewhere near it. It doesn't matter too much, but I now want to add a modifier to it, and that is shrink wrap modifier. And I want to select the fluid domain to shrink to. You can see it sort of deformed slightly there. At this point, I'm going to give the object a simple material just so that we can differentiate which is which. We'll give this a sort of orangey color, and we'll give the fluid domain a slightly blue color so we can see which object we're looking at. Make sure it's on surface, but other than that, that's all we need to do with that. What I think I will do though is I'll go into edit mode and we'll subdivide a couple more times. It doesn't matter too much, to be honest with you. You're not going to actually see this mesh, but obviously it's good to have enough geometry that it does follow the shape of the fluid domain. And you can see it, if I draw it in here, it's actually running up there and following the fluid. So it's not square because it's square because the fluid domain becomes square. So then go to Object Properties, under Visibility, and just turn off In Renders. We've got a couple of others in here because we're in Cycles mode at the moment. So I will quickly go up here and change this to Eevee, and there you see those other options have disappeared now. So it's visible here, but it won't be visible when we render. So okay, we've got another mesh which is forming its shape to the fluid, and now what we can do, because that doesn't currently have any physics properties, is that we can use that as the source for a fire simulation. So I'm going to go up to here and just say quick effects, quick smoke. It's made it wireframe, but we've still got our mesh there. And you can see that mesh is already the source for a smoke simulation. We want to make some changes, but nevertheless, that's a good start. So we already have a smoke simulation following the fluid. So I'll call up another window and we'll make that the shader window. I've selected my smoke inflow object, and under here I'm going to change that to fire plus smoke, so we get both. What you can do if you don't want the fire to start straight away is if we go to the beginning of our animation and we'll set density to 0 and press I to set a keyframe and fuel to 0 and again press I to set a keyframe. Then we'll come up to frame 20, say, so that's really roughly where the fluid, in fact we'll go slightly further than that as the fluid starts to expand out, about frame 25. We will again keyframe at 0, so we've got an area where there is no smoke, or there won't be. But then we'll go up to frame 30 and we'll set both of those, density to 1 and fuel to 1, and again keyframe them just by hovering the mouse over and pressing I, and you'll notice you get a solid diamond shape there as well. So it won't change at the moment because we haven't rebaked anything yet, or we haven't forced it to rebake. I set surface emission down a little bit. You can set it even further than that. We're using a plane, so I clicked is planar, and because the fluid is moving around, I told it to use initial velocity, which essentially gives some movement to the smoke as it's emitted, but otherwise left those by default. I also said use a texture. And this was just to make the flame emission a bit more interesting, but we'll come back to that in a little bit. So there's our smoke being emitted, but we want it to not emit straight away. So let's select our smoke domain. We will want a much higher resolution or divisions of the smoke domain, but we'll leave that at default for the moment. All of this can stay at default and no collisions, so that'll allow the smoke or flame to exit rather than filling the volume. I used adaptive domain, which just helps to speed things up a little bit. You can use dissolve if you want it to disappear. I didn't use that. We'll select the end of the cache as 100 frames, as that's the length of my animation here. And I'll just go and tweak the resolution. Let's put it up to 40, the same as the fluid simulation, just so that it rebakes. And there you can see the flame is starting at somewhere around the frame 30 where we told it to. And you can see we've got lots of flame and smoke there. There we go, we get to about frame 30 and everything starts happening. It's very low resolution at the moment, obviously. So if we go to rendered view, what do we have? Well, at the moment, not an awful lot. We've got a grey background. I'll add a lamp into the scene just so that we've got some illumination, and we'll make the background black. But although we can see that there's smoke, there's no flame. So we need to make some changes up here for that. The default principled volume shader does have what you need to start to create a flame effect. It has this thing called black body intensity. So black body relates to the idea that something emits radiation, including light, dependent on how hot it is. So as it gets hotter, it emits more light. It starts off with infrared light, goes through red, orange, yellow, and then eventually becomes white, and then gets brighter as it heats up and emits shorter and shorter wavelengths as it gets hotter. So that's what this area is about. So the idea of this is that it can give you more realistic fire effects. All we've got in there at the moment is the density attribute, which is what's giving us the general smoke effect. So what I'm going to do is add an input, which is an attribute. I'm going to duplicate that node. Into one of them, I'm going to put density, all lowercase. So this is basically a reference to the volumetric smoke that's been created, to the cache file, if you like. And then in the other one, I'm going to put an attribute called flame, which is the same thing, but for the areas that have been defined as flame. But this is not so much about how dense the flame is, this is about how hot it is. So next, I'm going to add a converter, which is a color ramp, because we're 3D artists, so we've got to play around with it. We can't just use what's provided. And I'm going to take those two blocks, each into their own color ramp. And then I'm going to add converter, which is a math node, set that to multiply, duplicate that. Again, the outputs of the two color ramps go into that. And then the output of the density row goes into, unsurprisingly, the density input. And the output from the flame row goes into the temperature. I set the black body intensity, so how much of what we see is contributed by black body effects, to 10. For the flame, I set the multiplier to 2000. That seemed to work for me. There you go, we've got some flame now. And then we can adjust how that flame's working by tweaking our color ramp. And I had that set to B spline, just to give me a bit more of a gentle change from one. So you can see there, we've got more yellow and orange. And that sort of eats away at the flame, very sort of almost embers there. And then we start to get the white flame coming in there where it's very, very hot. And then a similar thing up here. I had mine set to about 47. So that's much more dense smoke. I had that set to ease and just pulled up the bottom a little bit just to reduce the amount of smoke slightly. This is the preview render, so it won't be exactly like this in the proper render. I changed the color of the smoke to basically black, and the absorption color I set up a little bit. So it's just a sort of dark gray. Now, one thing to note is that although it seems like we're getting light emitted because of our black body effects, in Eevee it won't actually reflect on anything. So if you've got some barrels like I did and you want to show light being thrown on those barrels, you'll need to add a lamp into the scene and then animate that to coincide with the occurrence of the flame in your scene. Other than that, that's all there is to it. In cycles, you will get flame reflected off it. But of course, being volumetrics, it will take a lot longer to render. So let's put this resolution up. I used about 128. Let's go for 64. Go back to the beginning and let's just play that. You can see it's taking quite a bit longer now. This is where you might want to switch over to modular so that you can bake it, see if it's working, then bake the whole lot rather than just playing it through like this. There we go. Let me just quickly add some extra geometry into the scene just to make it a bit easier to see. So there's a floor plane. That's not going to interfere or interact in any way with the simulation. Now, because we're in Eevee, and even when we're previewing with cycles, you'll be using Eevee, you see we're getting these stripes across there, but that's an artifact of the way Eevee renders volumetrics. So if we do a quick render, we'll need to move our camera a little bit, I think. So we'll move the camera back a little bit, up a little bit, and then just point it down slightly. And we'll perhaps turn our sun lamp up a little bit as well. And we'll see what that's like. So there we can see our basic simulation. At the moment, we haven't really got a proper material on our fluid simulation. It has a go, but the thing is, by default, you get no transparency in Eevee materials. You have to make a little change here. We'll go for hashed there. We'll say screen space refraction and subsurface translucency. So I found Alpha Blend to work slightly better. So it's got a volumetric absorption in there at the moment. We'll take that out, and we'll also take out the glass shader. And we'll just add a principled shader into the surface. And we'll have a certain amount of alpha and a lot of transmission. If I turn this little option off here, overlays, that turns most of that off. And I can also go to particles and just turn off the view of those particles. We don't really need them anyway once we've got our simulation sorted out. And you can see it's still a low resolution fire simulation that needs a lot of tweaking. But we've got our basic liquid there, and we can turn our roughness right down. Then we can go to our scene settings. We can turn on screen space reflections, which gives us a few more highlights. Turn off half res trace if you want. We can turn the resolution of volumetrics right up. Turn the samples up. It's all going to slow down the render, of course. And I went up to 0.9 on there. And if we now select our smoke domain, we can perhaps turn down the density of the smoke a little bit. This is preview mode, so it's not entirely how it would look. And perhaps we'll give our liquid a bit of a color, just backing off that transparency a bit. And then we'll give that a render. And you can see it's taking quite a bit longer to render now. And you'll want to set your inflow object as invisible as well. And of course, play around with the flame settings quite a bit. But essentially, that's all there is to creating a basic fire and smoke simulation and also having it sourced from the fluid. So if I shrink this back, you can see that the fire is now very much associated with the fluid. And of course, we're getting a little bit of smoke generated as well. The one other little thing that I did was just to create a texture to make the fire different from just being everywhere at once, because it does tend to lick around in real life. So come down to textures and say new. With the smoke domain selected, I set it to distorted noise. I left it on Blender original. I left all the defaults. Then go to your fire and smoke inflow object. Come all the way down to the bottom. Turn on texture. And then turn on the texture that you just created. Mine's just called texture. You may need to make it rebake, of course. So to do that, I'm just going to select my smoke domain and we'll just change the resolution there and then start it going again. And you can already see we're now getting smoke appear in patches rather than just everywhere. And you can play around with the scale and so on. It just makes it slightly more interesting. And at this point, we can play around with some of our other settings, perhaps bring some of the smoke back now. So I hope you found that useful. If you did, let me know. If you enjoy these videos, don't forget to click like and subscribe. I have a Facebook channel and a Twitter account, and links to these will be in the description below. Thanks a lot, and I'll see you in the next tutorial.